Hello and welcome to the BFI London Film Festival and to this LFF Screen Talk. My name's Jonathan Romney and I'm very happy to be here on Zoom talking to a German director who is one of the most inventive and inexhaustibly interesting of today's storytellers in cinema. You'll know his work, Yella, Barbara, The State I'm In, Ghosts, and the film that's in the festival this year, Undine. Will you please welcome Christian Petzold? Christian, we're going to talk about your entire career, really, and about your ideas about film and how you became a filmmaker. But maybe let's start with Undine, which maybe people will have already had the chance to see in the festival. But it's unusual in your cinema in that it's based on a fairy tale, a myth, but at the same time, it's not that unusual because your films have often been based on stories that already people know, that they're reworkings of either other films or novels or, let's say, cinema archetypes. This one is particularly German in that it's based on a very German myth of Undine, the water nymph, which has been treated in novels, poems, opera. So why did it fascinate you?
Yeah, you're right. I think about that. That, for example, Yella was based on Carnival of Souls or this old Civil War novel, no? Old Creek Bridge, and the Postman Always Rings Twice was Jericho, and so on. This, I think, it really, you're right. This is the first German myth I have make a transition of. I must say, and it's a very famous German myth. And for example, when I'm leaving here my flat and go down to the street not far away, 200 meters, there's a pharmacy, and this pharmacy, it's named Undine Pharmacy. Yeah? I asked the pharmacist, why it's Undine. He says, because this pharmacy is near a canal with water. Yeah? And so many, many pharmacists have used the name Undine when they are near water, something to do with water. Yeah? And because Undine is, she's a nymph, she's a little bit like a witch, but on the other hand, you know, in all myths, all these women could also heal people, so therefore this complex structure, a pharmacist, he can heal and he can kill too, he's working with poison, and so I was in a discussion, and then I ask my friends, Undine, everybody knows the word, but nobody can remember the myth. And I have read the myth again, and an old thing from 19th century by a German writer who's famous, but not very good. But this story is his masterpiece. I have to tell the story again. No, I have.
You don't have to.
People are looking at it. Okay. But so I find it again. And it was, for me, it was, it describes, because I've made 6 movies with Nina Hoss before. And we are always discuss our relationship. I'm a male director. She's a blonde actress. And something is happening. Yeah. Something is happening with projections. Yeah. We are talking about Tippi Hedren and Alfred Hitchcock, Rita Hayworth and Orson Welles. We are talking about this relationship, which is a relationship of power, and a relationship of a male subjectivity, and a male projection. And so we try to destroy this relationship. We deconstruct, you can say, if you are want to study philosophy. I found this Undine in the time when I worked with Nina Hoss, and for me it was, then I found, then I made this transit before, and in transit there is this interesting thing that the character Paula Bear plays is, she's on a ship which sank, and so she died, and she's her lover, played by Franz Rogowski, he's on the bench, on the beach in Marseille, and he's waiting for her. Perhaps she came back from the death, yeah, like in the Greece myth or so. And so I said to them, I have this myth Undine, and in Undine, Paula Bear is coming back from the water and looking for the love on landscape and on the land. And he is a diver who's going into the sea, is looking for her love under the sea. And so we have a correlation. Yeah, it's the second part of a story.
Yeah,
it's understandable.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely. Yeah. And it's interesting that very often you've made films focused on women, Yella, Barbara, etc., and very rarely focused on men, but in the last film, Transit, you did that. It's about a hero and what happens to him. And in this film, it's sort of slightly more balanced. It's about a woman who's fascinated with a man and about a man who's fascinated by a woman. So you seem to have kind of synthesized those two poles of your cinema.
Yeah. I received an award in Venice when I stayed there, Women on Cinema Award. And the first moment, I feel totally ashamed about that because I was the only male who received this award. I thought perhaps they want to kill me or something like that during the ceremony, but it was serious. And then I thought about that when I stayed in Venice the first time 20 years ago with the movie The State I'm In, there was one of my masters, I must say, Claude Chabrol was there in the same hotel, and he has made an interview there. Yeah? And I want to hear but it's all in French. I can't speak French, no words. Yeah? And but it looks as if he's very concentrated during the interview. And I asked him, can you make a translation? Can't understand what he's talking about. And so, and 10 years later, I've read this interview he made in Venice. And the interviewer question was, why your main characters almost are female? Yeah, Stéphane Audran, Isabelle Huppert, Romy Schneider, yeah? Like me, the 80% are stories about women. And he said, very interesting, very short answer who clears everything. He said, men are living, women are surviving, cinema is about surviving. This was his answer. And I think it's something to do with this. Yeah? And in Transit, it was so that in Transit, there is the story of a man, but he fell in love also to a woman like a projection, yeah, like the Tippi Hedrens of, or the John Moreau's of, oh, yeah. It's a movie about male subjectivity and male and if there is a man who think when I get this woman then I survive the world and it doesn't work and so we have the same discussion I have had with Nina Hoss I have during the shooting with Paula Bär who said to me that the novel from Anna Segers she thought when she had read the novel first.
This is Transit.
Transit, the novel Transit. Yeah. She said she thought it was written by a man and not by a woman, but it's a novel of a woman. And then we have so fantastic discussions. I said perhaps she used the male look and subjectivity to the world to survive because she think she was 1940, 1941 in Marseille. She was surrounded by Nazis. She's a Jew. Yeah? She had two children. She's weak. Yeah? And in her novel, she transformed herself into male to survive. Yeah? This was interesting. Yeah? And from this discussion, I know that both actors, Paula and Franz, are really intelligent. And so this Undine discussion develops out of this Transit discussion.
It's really interesting that you mentioned Chabrol as one of your masters, because one thing you have in common with him is a love for very, very simple storytelling. You know, like Chabrol, you tell stories which are very basic, almost minimal, very little stylistic fuss, and yet they have this resonance, and the stories are often very strange. and they feel strange partly because they are so straightforward.
Yeah. And you know, I think in England it's a little bit like in Germany. In the 70s, when I grew up, yeah, in the 70s, we are educated by television. We are in many spheres. We are educated, but also educated in cinema. Yeah, and we have all Chabrol movies, and we have people who describes us something about Chabrol, who make interpretations, and they open our minds to cinema.
Presenting the films on TV.
Yeah, and it doesn't. Today, we can't see a Chabrol movie since 10 years. No Chabrol movie in the German TV. But it's not a private TV. It's a TV by state. Yeah? But there is no education anymore, no curation anymore. Yeah? But in this time, when I saw the Chabrol movies when I was 18, 19, 20, yeah, in this small town between Wuppertal and Düsseldorf, yeah, I learned so much, yeah, because they are very, very simple. They are very, very complex. And these years of film between 68 and 75, this 7 years of Chabrol, it's one masterpiece after another. And I remember them all. Yeah? And the actors, they have to look at the Chabrol movies during our rehearsals each time. Yeah? Because you also, as an actor, you can learn much in these movies.
Yeah. I want to ask you another question about storytelling, because you were taught by and you worked with the filmmaker, artist, theorist as well, Harun Farocki. And he's very much thought of as an experimenter and an avant-gardist. And he worked with you on many of your scripts. And I believe that one of the things he told you was, it took me 10 years to realize that experiment lies in the mainstream. You don't have to look to the avant-garde, because mainstream cinema is actually every bit as experimental.
Yeah, this was interesting, because when I start studying at the Film Academy, he was a professor there, I thought he's a cold man. Yeah, because you know, in Germany we have this two lines. We have the blue and the red line. The belletristic, belletristic literature, and the code line, it's essay, yeah? It's a theory. Yeah? And for Harun, was something happened in the 70s. They threw him out of the red part to the blue part. Yeah? And he was very, very disappointed about that, because he loves storytelling. He loves the mainstream. Yeah? And he knows that in mainstream stories, yeah, there is something happening. Yeah? You can read them in another way, not the subject like today in the festival movies, yeah? But there is something inside. Yeah? And so he started to make seminars where we see 10, 12 movies in 3 weeks. Yeah? And we are sitting at an editing table and talking about these movies. And all these movies are story movies, also not mainstream. It's Rossellini. Okay, it's also mainstream. Yeah? We saw a Rossellini movie. We saw John Flynn, The Outfit, fantastic movie from 1973. Then we saw Charlie Varick by Don Siegel, Rumblefish by Coppola. Yeah? And we saw it. And we deconstructed them on the editing table. We are looking what this means, this cut, this montage, yeah? this music. But then after, at 4 p.m., we go back into the cinema and look the whole movie, and the movie was not destroyed. The movie was richer. So interpretation and thinking makes movies richer. This is my second education after the TV education, Harun Farocki education. And then we played together in a football team, and then I was very shy. And after our shower, yeah, I had given to him my first manuscript. a script of a short movie. And he gives me a phone call the next day and said we can work. Yeah, and I know that he loves to get back into the red, warm, belletristic group. Yeah? And it was always fantastic. He's during we are writing, and we make the dialogues together. He's always playing the female parts, and I'm the male. He loves to play a woman. Yeah? So it was a fantastic time. 25 years we have worked.
And he died a few years ago. But do you feel that you're still working with his influence?
Yes, I know. I know. For example, he had fantastic jokes about bad dialogues. Yeah? Why are you so pale? I was in jail for 25 years. Ah, I remember you killed your wife with the axe. Yeah, but I was innocent. Yeah, I heard this. Yeah, like, so I always, during when I'm writing now, I'm writing on my own, but he's sitting beside me. Yeah, and I can hear his voice.
How did you get into cinema in the first place? What fascinated you? I know that early on you started, one of your first experiences was running a film club.
Yeah, but before it was so like this that I was 14 or 15, and in our high school there was a new guy is coming in, and he has long hair. Yeah, he has London music with him. Yeah, the punk music, and he has also new books. Yeah, and he had given me the book, this interview between François Truffaut and Alfred Hitchcock. Yeah, and this was my entrance to cinema. I have seen many movies before in the clubs or so, but not. I was no cineastic. But after I've read this book, I know a door was opened, I must say. Yeah? And with this book, I go then to the library and have read books about cinema. But I haven't seen the movies. I read books about Henri René. My desire to see all these movies was really big, really big. And then I make my civil work, because in Germany you can say I don't want to go to military, but then you have to make a social or civil work. Yeah? And my civil work was a film club. Yeah, and I can write a magazine each week, a small one. Yeah, and three times a week we have screenings, and because it was from the Christian Church, yeah, this film club, they have this idea. You have to take one big mainstream movie with Bud Spencer and Terence Hill or something like that, and then art on the other two, a double feature. And so we have, I remember there was a movie Flying to the Air with Terence Hill and Bud Spencer. And well, after...
Italian Western stars.
Yeah. This. And then after Der Würgeengel, what's the Buñuel movie where they can't leave the room? I don't know the original title. Hmm?
Big Terminating Angel.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah. And so then in this film club, there all the people, the young people there, they're rockers, motorbikers. Yeah? They have fear, and they never laugh about Terence Hill, but they have fear for the Buñuel. They are talking for 1 week about the Buñuel movie because this movie has something to do with their identity. They are living as proletarians, yeah, without any future. Well, there are no jobs anymore, industrial jobs. But they understand we can't leave our room. Yeah? It was interesting. Since this time, I think the separation between mainstream and art house is the worst thing we have had done in the last 30 years.
Right, and that is certainly one of the strangest double bills I've ever heard of. You studied film in Berlin at the film school dffb, and people talk about your generation, people from that background, as being a kind of Berlin school. So names like Marinada, Valeske Gliesebach, Angela Schanalek, Thomas Aslan, and you. It's not easy to see what you have in common, but do you think you have certain attitudes to cinema or certain attitudes to the world in common?
Two weeks ago, there was a retrospective of the documentary work of Hartmut Bitomsky. Starts here in a small cinema, Zeughaus.
It's yeah, he was your other teacher at the school.
Another teacher. Yeah. And so we haven't seen these movies for many, many, many years. Yeah? They're now on DCP, they're digitalized. Yeah? And I was not there because I have to go to Venice, but people told me they have seen a movie about the history of the German production company UFA. Yeah? UFA, you know, they make Fritz Lang's Metropolis, but later Hugenberg, the dean of the UFA, was a fascist. Yeah? He makes all the propaganda movies for the Nazis. And Hartmut had made a portrait of the history of this UFA. And someone told me Angela Schanlek was in the movie, Thomas Aslan was in the movie, I was in the movie. And I remember this we are for 2 months, we have worked together. Yeah? And we learned Hartmut's fantastic cineast, but also I think this was the time Berlin school starts. Yeah? To work, to look how someone is working, to open the eyes to film history, to feel the history, not like in a museum. Yeah? All these movies we have seen are present. They are not period. Yeah? And the discussions are, we are so cautious. We don't want to destroy the movies with big sentences. We watched, we learned to see. This I can say. And perhaps this is something to do with Berlin School. Yeah? We are not, I'm a friend of Thomas and I know Angela, but we are not working together, but something started in this time, I'm really sure.
Right. When you first started working, you made feature films for TV and you've continued to make a number of films. You've continued in TV, you've worked on series, you made an episode for the three-part film Dreileben. And I wonder over the years how you feel TV has changed, the language of TV, and if it would tempt you now to do what a lot of directors are making, which is to do a whole long form series of your own.
Yes, it was because I love the film noir, yeah, the B-movie from in Hollywood. I'm really sure after we have made Phoenix, I'm really sure that something to do, this is a German, most of them are Germans who made these movies in Hollywood. They are in an exile. Yeah? And so perhaps this strange world had something to do with my own experience in Germany. And so we have this theory that the B movie doesn't exist in cinema anymore. Yeah, it had gone to TV, like the police stories, yeah? Crime stories, and so on. So we have to do TV to find the B movies again, and to work 20 days of shooting, not much money, yeah? Very cheap. Yeah? We tried this, but this I think was a historical mistake. Yeah? Because it's a TV movie, yeah? Or a TV series has nothing to do with the B movies. Yeah? The TV is always looking for, not for trivial pulp things, the TV is always looking for themes. Yeah? So when they make a crime, it has something to do that they can make a talk show later of this theme. Yeah? That the actors who played, for example, a pederast, yeah?
Yep.
Yeah? Later they have to talk about abuse of children. Yeah? So this is TV today. TV today is journalism. Yeah? It's the feature movies are always very poor in their cineastic way, but they try to to use the movies as a medium for some themes and subjects. And so this was a mistake. In the first, when I had written the state I'm in with Harun in Berkeley, we have seen the first episode of The Sopranos, and we are so euphoric, yeah, because this is great. This is not a short story. This is novel. Yeah, it's a novel which develops. Like after the first season, they cut out the film music. They find their own language. Yeah, it was like Thomas Mann, Buddenbrooks. It was like Balzac, yeah? But very modern. And I think this could be the future, I said. And Harun and I, we had always talked about to create a serial. Yeah? But after, I must say, after my COVID quarantine, and I have seen Netflix and Amazon for 4 weeks out of the bed, I'm through with this, I must say. I can't stand it any longer. There are too many serials, there are too many script doctors, there are too many writer rooms, and there are too many ideas, and ideas in a bad way. For some very good things, like I like this English, The River, this short serial with Stellan Skarsgård as a policeman who was accompanied by his dead woman, yeah, he had worked together with, or Chernobyl, I like very much, yeah, to see this. But I'm not so, when I was in Venice, I said, cinema is the future, not TV, I must say, it's like this.
Yeah. So when you started making feature films for the cinema, did you have to learn a different language, or did you have to learn a different set of rules? So your early films, like The State I'm In, Ghost.
Yeah, at the for me it was no difference, because these three movies I have made before for TV, these are also movies for cinema, but very small budget. It's like a debut. Yeah? When you were leaving the academy, you can make two or three movies with not much money, yeah? So it's not real TV. You are in the TV, you are also in an exile position, yeah? And when I make The State I'm In, I remember, this was interesting, it's about the RAF and the German terrorism, yeah? And I received the first money from the state. Yeah, the state gives me money. The state, the terrorists are fighting against. He has given me the money, but the TV don't want to give money. So we can't do it for 2.5 years. The TV station said no, not interested anymore. Yeah? They are more state, more censorship than the state itself. Yeah? This was interesting. Interesting. And when we start shooting The State I'm In, I was in a mood, in a really aggressive mood, I must say. I was in a terror mood, yeah? Because I have to wait for 2.5 years for money. We have no money. Nobody's believing in us. We are like a group, an underground group who wants to drop a bomb somewhere. Yeah? But we don't use a bomb, we use a camera. Yeah? It was like this. And it was a very... after 2 or 3 days of shooting, it was a very happy and great time. Yeah, because I always dreamed when I saw the photos of Rossellini or Coppola when they're with their families, yeah, during the shooting, they're sitting there eating and then they're shooting, and this relaxed, yeah, very really cool and relaxed working I like so much, and I try to realize it during State I'm In. I think it was like this, you know? And so I know this could be a way for me.
So that film is about someone, a girl trying to get away from German history and the legacy of her parents in militant activities. And then your following film, Ghost, is about, again, it's about people trying to get away from their own past. And it seems like it's consistent with the TV films you made and the films you've made subsequently, which are very often about people, you know, floating without roots or without a past, characters pared down to the absolute minimum. You know, they're existential dramas in a classic way, but they also feel very much political dramas. They're about people trying to find their place, you know, in a contemporary capitalist world.
Yeah, I think sometimes, looking into my own biography, if I can find roots, yeah, why I'm so interested in these terms, yeah, and I remember my parents are refugees, yeah, from the East, yeah, and they came to West Germany, and they thought always that they are part of the society, but they are not really a part of the society. You know, this little small cities, yeah, they don't like people who came from outside. They don't like them. Yeah? You're not really part of our society. It was also for me in school, it was like this: you are the son of the refugees. I grew up in a small part of the city on the outskirts. Yeah, they call it Little Zwickau. Zwickau is a city in the German Democratic Republic. Yeah? So we are not really part of it. Yeah? And then my father lost his job for 3.5 years. Yeah? And he had built this small house before. And there was, you know, when the architects who build houses, they build a house for families where the man is working, the woman stay home, the children they will have a room, there's a bathroom and a kitchen and a living room, and not more. And in this moment, my father had lost his job and he has to stay 24 hours a day at home. And this is something we can think about, this pandemic situation today too. There is no room for him. Yeah? There's just the sleeping room and the living room, but it's not a room of his own. It's too small. So sometimes when I came home from school, yeah, I saw my father sitting in his car and hear music, because this car with a tape player, yeah, was his room. And then he starts drinking alcohol until he died. Yeah? But this is also something what for me, it's political. The architecture of the house, yeah, is also a political situation. It's these houses are built to live in a way the society wants you to live. Yeah? And when you are not part of it anymore, you can die. Yeah? Or you are on the outside. In these things I was always interested in. And Harun and I, we talked so much about in cinema, you can't see work so often, people who are working. You, yeah? When you see a writer in a Wim Wenders movie, yeah? he take out his typewriter, yeah? Whiskey, cigarette, or and blanket here, paper, yeah? And he starts writing, you see 2-3 shots. Yeah? So, and then he's typing the end, put it, and you see that he has there 180 pages. There is no work in cinema. Yeah? Sometimes you can see it in fantastic movies like Blue Collar, for example, by Paul Schrader. You can see work, but it's not often. And but on the other hand, our identity, yeah, is work. Yeah? When we are on a party, everybody says, what are you doing? And when you say nothing, you can go home. Yeah? So you are nothing. You need, I'm working on a novel, or you need work. But the work is, we are losing work, yeah, in our societies. The work is going away. It's the industrial work is going away. I talked with Johanna Hook about this fantastic Robert White song, Shipbuilding, which is one of the best songs ever made about this schizophrenic situation of the working class. Yeah? And it always drives me to tears. Yeah? And so there's work on the one hand we need for our identity, and there is no work anymore. And the cinema, what the cinema is doing with this term? These are things I'm thinking about.
Yeah, one of the things about your films that non-German viewers might not always get, and I've had to have it explained to me sometimes, but they're often about very specific places, which are often connected both with different types of work and different aspects of German history. So for example, your film Wolfsburg, which is about Wolfsburg as a kind of car manufacturing town, and Yellow, which is set in Hanover, which is to do with a particular financial and business world to do with those kind of business zones around that town. And it's very always very specific about German geography, German history, and as you say, types of German work.
Yeah, that's right. In this time, Harun still was living. Yeah? And during our research, for example, for Jella, yeah? Hanover, this was the expo. The band Kraftwerk, I like very much, had made a song for the expo. You have this, it's like a documenta from capitalism, of the capitalism. Yes, you have the American pavilion, Hungarian pavilion. Everybody wants to show the production and the capitalistic creativity. Yeah? So this part, Jella was shot. Yeah? But then there was a Harun and I, we went into a big insurance company. Yeah, what is there? And in the lobby of the insurance company, there were 500 containers with wheels on. Yeah, yeah. And I looked at the containers. And they're a little bit like the containers in planes, what the stewardess have for the drinks, like this. Yeah. And on each container, there are flowers and photos of children, yeah? And letters, yeah? And I asked, and they said, no, we don't have, nobody has here a room of his own, yeah? Because everybody has his own container, yeah? He's going to his to an office room, which is free, and puts his Wi-Fi inside and can work, yeah? So the first moment, it's so they don't need so many space, because often in insurance companies, office rooms are empty because someone is outside and so on. And this was so a sad picture of the containers, because in further times, you have a neighbor for 10, 15 years in the bureau. You can talk about union, you can talk about your rights, you can talk about your feelings. Yeah? But now you have just the container, not more. Yeah? And you put the container on the space, but you're an individual. Yeah? And each day you have another room, yeah? And another neighbor, and another comrade. Yeah? And in another company, and this destroys structures. Yeah? And this was so interesting. We are talking about this, and Nina Hoss was beside us, and this goes into her work. Yeah, it's not a movie about the containers, but it's something about the capitalism in the year 2006.
Yeah. Yeah.
So.
You mentioned Wim Wenders just now, and both he and Fassbinder were fascinated with Germany's relation to America and German cinema's relation to Hollywood. And of course, there's every European country has a different relation to Hollywood, but there's a particular relationship between Germany and Hollywood in that people like Fritz Lang and Douglas Sirk made Hollywood, and then those ideas came back to Germany via Fassbinder. Can you talk about your relation to the German Hollywood tradition, and in particular your use of melodrama, which seems to be the form that most fascinates you?
When I was young and I saw my first Wim Wenders movie, Alice in the Cities, yeah, I was 14. I saw this movie because of the soundtrack of the band The Can. Yeah, I'm a big fan of The Can this time, and I was totally impressed because this movie, Alice in the Cities, mostly was shot in Wuppertal, and there's one fantastic scene. Alice wants to have an ice cream, and she and Rüdiger Vogler went into a gelateria for ice cream, and there's a boy who's buying himself one ball. Yeah, it's the right word for this.
Like a scoop.
Yeah. And then he goes to the virtual jukebox, yeah, and puts his some money in, and you can hear "Going Up the Country" by Kenneth Heath, 3 minutes, and he's and you see the boy and the ice cream, and this gelateria was the gelateria I always have bought my ice cream when I was young. Yeah, I'm living there, 10 minutes by bicycle away from it. Yeah, and so. For me, the place which is very ordinary for me was bewitched by the movie. Yeah? And for me, Wim Wenders has more to do with American movies than with the German movies. Yeah? He's something to do with John Ford, yeah? And Howard Hawks and The Big Sky. And so, but Fassbinder was someone who has, for me, it was Wim Wenders at the beginning was the most important filmmaker, but it changed to Fassbinder later because I've seen Douglas Sirk, I've seen the German exile people, yeah, Otto Preminger, yeah, Edgar Ulmer. I saw their movies with the help of Fassbinder. Yeah? And so they come back by Fassbinder to Germany. The Germans come back by Fassbinder, the Americans by Wenders. Yeah, so a little bit like this.
Yeah. Can you talk about your work with Nina Hoss? You made 6 films with her, I think, and if you can maybe tell us how you started working with her. But I wonder whether all those films feed each other. So when we see Yella, some of that role carries over into Barbara, and some of that role carries over into Phoenix, et cetera, et cetera.
Yeah. When we have made our first movie, it was Toter Mann. Yeah? I don't know the English title.
Dead Man,
but the English title was
different English
something
title.
To remind me, something to remind me. Yeah. I think so, yeah. And it was after the first 3 or 4 days of shooting, I have the feeling I found someone. Yeah? I found someone who I'm never searched before. It's like I know this is someone I'm searched for. Yeah, and then we make this movie, and Nina, she was for me, she was like a stranger in Germany. She's totally German. She's blonde, and she can speak so fantastic about Germany, but she's also on the outside of Germany. And this was a position Nina and I can tell stories from, yeah? Not to be really a part of it. Yeah? Sometimes the characters Nina played are thrown out of the society. Sometimes she wants to leave. She wants to leave the societies. Sometimes she wants to come back into our society, and she's always searching for luck. Yeah, this is the thing I like it in cinema, the luck searchers. And so we can when we make our first movie during the shooting, I have given her Wolfsburg the script in the train and say we have to do it, we have to work on. And so I think all these 6 movies we made together, with some interruptions, all these movies depend on each other, and also are a result of our conversations. Yeah, one conversation creates the next subject. It's also something to do with Harun, who loved Nina a lot, yeah, because he found also something in her that we are very close to her in the movies, but on the other hand, she don't need us. Yeah, this was so interesting. She don't need us. She, yeah? And so we are a part of her energy, but she's not working for the camera. She's on the run. Yeah, and this I like this position. I met her 2 weeks ago at the airport, and I thought that we can work on in 1, 2, 3 years again and find another path. Yeah?
Something interesting about your movies is they're always very simple. The stories are almost like fables, but sometimes they're absolutely realistic, like Barbara, which is feels a very historically grounded story of the old East and the old West. Sometimes they're completely dreamlike, which like Yella, which is an extended dream, almost with a supernatural element. But sometimes they're also on the frontier between the believable and the extraordinary. So Phoenix, yeah, which is about a woman who comes back from the camps after World War II and has facial reconstruction to look like herself, but people don't know it's her. People think it's just someone who happens to look like her. Mm-hmm. And we either believe it or we don't, but this is somewhere between realism and the absolutely extraordinary. So you're always playing with the limits of what you can ask an audience to believe. Yeah.
I read that Roberto Rossellini has a bed 3 meters long and 3 meters, 9 square meters, yeah? And Eisenstein too. Yeah? And I have also a bed like this. Yeah? And it's...
Sorry. Can you explain that again? I'm not getting it. Can you just say that again? But
Rossellini has a 9 square meter bed for sleeping, yeah? And Eisenstein too, yeah? And I has also a very, very big bed. Yeah? It's something to do with, I think, when the stories are simple. Yeah? I like it when you have a very simple story. A man is coming out of a bus, has just $1, yeah? There's a diner, there's a woman in the diner, there's some, for me, these are really stories. Yeah? But the story, when I write down a simple story like this, yeah? And then I go in the afternoon, which is very hard for a Protestant to sleep in the afternoon, yeah? When I go there in my 9 square meter bed, yeah? I dream this scene again. Not really in a deep sleep, it's an afternoon sleep. And then I write it again, yeah? Because I think cinema is always on the border between this realism and something in this realism is fiction. Yeah? It's dreamlike. Yeah? When I'm in the cinema, and I missed the cinemas during the lockdown so much, yeah? It's not TV, it's not sit in front of your flat screen. You're in a cinema, it's getting dark, and you are, your body is there, you know it, you can do breath, but your mind is away, yeah? So you are somnambul, yeah? You are, on one hand you are there, on the other hand you are gone. And so we have this, I think movies had to be on this border, yeah? And so, for example, at Phoenix, the Germans don't like it, yeah? Because it's forbidden to have a dream with the camps and the Nazis, yeah? Yeah. Because as if the Nazis are the only reality, yeah? And on the other hand, in the USA, it was a success because the people there, they know that dream and reality, they are in correspondency, yeah? It's for me very hard to tell this in English, I must say, yeah?
No, that's very clear. You did something that was also very interesting in your last film, Transit, where you took a novel about World War II and you shot it in the present day. So we didn't really know whether it's a story about World War II that just happens to be shot today with contemporary clothes, so it's a little bit Brechtian, or whether you're suggesting it's about history happening again now. It's almost, it could be dystopian science fiction. And because the film is sort of balanced between the two, we're not really sure what to make of it. And that's what makes it really fascinating.
Yeah. Yeah, it was first, Harun was still living on, and we have made a first draft of Transit together. And it was a period picture. Yeah? And after Phoenix, I was not interested in period pictures anymore, yeah? Because it's something to do with acting. I don't like that. When the German actors, they have costumes, old costumes for period pictures, they're playing theater, they're on stage. You have to destroy it totally. You have to show them Barry Lyndon 300 times to learn something. Yeah? But it's not, and it was too much work. And then Harun died, and I put this transit away and make two crime stories for TV. And then one day, in Germany, we have streets here where you have stones in front of the houses with names on from the people who are killed by the Nazis in the camps, who have lived in these houses in further times. So I think a city is both its history and its present in the same moment. You are today, this morning at 7 o'clock, I'm walked through Leipzig. I want to find the way back to the train station. Yeah, and I saw the old houses, the where Johann Sebastian Bach made his music. I saw the new houses from the German Democratic Republic, these ugly houses. Yeah, and so I saw the shopping malls were built after the crash of the German Democratic Republic. Yeah, and so everything is in the same moment there in the city. Why can't a movie make it like this? This was my question. And then I, from this moment on, I know there is correspondences between the refugees of today, the refugees of 41, the culture, the novelists and the cinematographers who had to leave Germany, and they're waiting Marseille, and they're unsolved, because nobody wants to hear their stories, nobody wants to see their movies, their ideas, they are killed or they have to go in exile. And so they're like ghosts, and ghosts are characters who wants to materialize again. Yeah, who wants to say, look at us, we are here. Yeah? But nobody is looking to them or to the history. And like the refugees today, everybody's looking, don't want to watch them. Yeah, we want to forget them on these Greece islands and so. Yeah? And so I have found something, but the only thing I have to do is to find the balance. Yeah? So that the reality of today and the reality of the history are in a balance, and they are working together. They come together, sometimes they exploded. The only thing I have to do is what my son said to me, don't use smartphones. Yeah. Yeah?
Okay, well, let me ask you about something else, about the balance between real and unreal worlds, because you've done the same again in Undine, your new film, which is very much rooted in Germany today. It's set in Berlin and Wuppertal, but it's also about myth, and it's about romance and fairy tale, but you always go for the realistic elements, the specific information about the Berlin architecture, etc.
Yes, you know, this museum, yeah, where Undine is working, it still exists. Yeah, you can, it's not far away from here, it's near the River Spree. And I was there as a visitor, Christoph Hochhäuser, a friend of mine, had showed it to me. And then it was a little bit like to go to church. Sometimes the children and I, and my wife, we make a walk there and look to the models of the city Berlin. We can see how Berlin was developed. We can see how Berlin was destroyed during the Second World War. We learned something about the city we are living in since many, many years. Yeah? And always there's an atmosphere like in a church. And sometimes once I sat there and looking to this small models, yeah? and then there was a group of people and there was a guide, yeah? And he's talking about Berlin. And I thought, when Undine is working here and she knows so much because she's living since centuries, yeah, and she's always has to go back into the water because she's betrayed by the lovers. Yeah?
You also have two fantastic actors in this film who worked with for the first time on Transit, and they're back again. So Paula Baer, who we first discovered in François Ozon's film France, and she has this incredibly sort of fragile but sort of mysterious air about her. And then Franz Rogowski, he's got this kind of nervy sort of muscular style, a bit like one of those Hollywood actors like John Garfield. You know, what makes them such a great combination together?
Yeah, they didn't know each other before we start making Transit. And there was one scene. Paula has, I think, 10 days of shooting, Franz 40 days of shooting. Paula was part of our work. She came to Marseille on the 5th or 6th days of shooting. And then she had to play together with Franz a long scene in a taxi, in the backseat of a taxi. Because we have to do it on this day because of the streets and logistic problems. And both came later, 1 week later, both came to me and asked me if they can do this scene again, which is normally not possible. It costs us a whole day, it's 50,000 euros, yeah? It's not possible. But they described their wish of such a fantastic way. Like they're like really good union leaders, yeah? And they say, and I know there's something happened between them. They're not a couple, nothing like this. It's nothing to do with love or emotions. It's something of a big trust, yeah? And also a fantastic kind of talking with each other, yeah, without any vanity, yeah, very modest, yeah. And so they said we have to do it again because we have discovered something in our relationship in the movie we didn't know on the 6 days of our shooting. Is it possible? And I said, okay, we can do it. I'm really sure because I want to be the master. I'm really sure it was good on the 6th day. You are not right, but they're totally right. And I must say, after this day of extra shooting, I must say that they are right. And so they are really, really happy that they killed me. Yeah, and from this moment on, I'm sure that they have found a way of talking and working together. Also in private things, when sometimes we met each other during dinner or so, that they trust each other in a way I've never seen this between actors before.
Yeah. Well, they are a fantastic duo, and everyone, you'll be able to see them in Undine, which is playing in the London Film Festival. Also with an introduction from Christian. So Christian, thank you very much for joining us today. Oh, it's been a real pleasure talking. And I hope you can come back and join us in the real world one of these days in the future festival.
I think 3-4 months, and then we can come back, and you are sitting in Spain, I'm in Berlin, people in England. It's the virtual world is shit, I must say. We have to smell and we have to taste, and I miss this totally. When I have seen Undine at the premiere in Berlin the first time, yeah. I can't see it during the Berlinale. I've seen it after the lockdown. I think, oh my God, they can touch each other so fantastic. Their kisses, their. So I'm sure that Zoom, what we are doing here, and other virtual things, has nothing to do with life, I must say.
Well, sometimes it is, but people will be able to see Undine in a real cinema, in the real world, in London. Thank you all very much for joining us, Christian.
Thank you.
And soon, I hope. All the best.
Thank you. Bye.